Today we're going to be taking a look at the new 2.0 firmware for the Nikon Z9, which for video shooters at least, might just be the greatest camera firmware update of all time. Actually, that makes for a good comment prompt. What has been your favorite firmware update from the past, whether for cameras or some other piece of tech? Let me know down below the like button. As far as disclosure, Nikon lent me this camera to make this video. I don't get to keep it. No money changed hands. The firmware is still considered to be pre-production or late beta. I'm told it's pretty much final, but there might be the odd hiccup that needs to be ironed out. But I'm happy to report I haven't really found any serious issues with this firmware during my testing. Also, this whole video is a continuation of my original review of the Z9. I'm not going to be repeating too much information from that video, so if you don't know anything about this camera, I suggest starting with that video first. So the headline feature here is that you can now record RAW internally to the CF Express card, and you can do that all the way up to 8K at 60 frames per second, and that's full frame with no limitations or gimmicks. And the files are actually a little higher resolution than 8K. They're 8256 by 4644, giving you enough room to crop out a 17:9 image while still maintaining the DCI 4320 lines of resolution. You can record at two compressions that they're calling high quality and normal, with normal being about half the size with no noticeable loss in detail. You can also record in a 4.1K full frame RAW up to 120 frames per second, and you can do that both internally or externally with ProRes RAW, but the ProRes RAW caps out at 60p. But to be honest, I've never really liked ProRes RAW, so I'm glad that Nikon basically makes that unnecessary by allowing for their own RAW to be recorded, which also works in DaVinci Resolve, unlike ProRes RAW. There's a few other resolution and frame rate combinations and some crop modes as well, and support for PAL frame rates. We'll get into the development panel for the RAW as well as some dynamic range tests in a minute, but first let's go over some of the other updates in this firmware package. So another big addition is the ability to toggle a switch to allow the 4K 60 mode, which was previously not oversampled, to be oversampled, bringing the image quality up to the same standard as that of the 4K 24 and 4K 30. This is awesome. I tested this feature as well as the 8K 60 RAW extensively and couldn't get either to overheat in my indoor studio environment. But Nikon did add an overheating sensitivity toggle, similar to what we've seen in Sony cameras, to expand the threshold for overheating. Keep in mind though that 8K 60 RAW files are quite large even when using the tighter compression. You're looking at about 25 minutes of record time for a 650 gigabyte CF Express card, so I presume storage will run out before the camera overheats. And regarding the 4K 60 oversample mode, I'm told the only consequence of enabling it is your battery runtime will shorten while it's active. In my tests, I got a yellow overheat warning after about an hour of oversampled 4K 60, and then an hour later, that warning turned red. And then I recorded for another 30 or so minutes before the battery was about to die, and so then I plugged it into USB power delivery, switched the camera to the standard overheating mode, and closed the screen, all to see if I could get it to shut down due to heat, and it didn't. It just kept recording. The body was quite hot to the touch at this point, but I couldn't actually get it to shut down. Now your results will likely vary depending on your environment, but I can safely say that I have no concerns with this camera in a studio setting. They've also added a red record frame indicator around the LCD and a dedicated video display mode that is reminiscent of the display on, say, a cine camera. And they've added a proper resizable waveform monitor that is accurate and easy to read. And what's great about the Z9 is that you can also mirror these overlays and tools onto your external display if you want to, with no blackouts or screen issues of any kind, which is actually how I was able to record those tools and show you in this video. They've also refined the shutter speed and ISO controls. For ISO, you can enable an option to move in 1/6 stops instead of just 1/3 stops if you want a more refined adjustment. And for shutter speed, they've given you a toggle to enable the ability to lower the shutter speed beyond the frame rate. So you can shoot 60 frames per second, for example, and shoot at less than 1/60th per second shutter. Now, using a slower shutter speed like 1/30th while shooting at 60 frames per second will give you a jerkier motion, but the option is there if you need it. But what I like most about it is that you can control whether it's enabled or not. That way, if it's disabled, you don't have to worry about accidentally undercranking your shutter like I do sometimes on other cameras that don't have shutter angle. This is the best way to implement this. Now, I'm mostly focusing on the video improvements in this episode, but they have added some new photo functionality as well, like the ability to capture images pre-shutter release for up to a second before you start shooting, basically giving you 1 second of safety buffer in case you were late on pressing the shutter before an important moment. You can customize the size and shape of your wide area AF box, and you can blend a series of images together in camera to make a multi-photo overlay. And there's been some AF improvements in low light situations, and they've even added a timer now during long exposure in bulb mode, so rather than timing it yourself on a separate device, you can see the timer count up on the LCD for as long as you're holding the shutter. and they even added 120 frames per second mode in the viewfinder. And there's a few other welcome enhancements that you can read about in the release notes. There's honestly like two pages of improvements. It's impressive. But let's jump into the meat of this video, which is what happens when you shoot RAW. So in camera, you still have your previous options like 8-bit and 10-bit H.265, and you've still got ProRes, but now you also have the NRAW option, which can be viewed as either NLOG or SDR. Of course, because this is RAW, this selection doesn't matter too much because you can just change it later. So think of it more as a preview choice. If you choose SDR, you have the option to implement one of Nikon's color modes like standard, portrait, or flat, but these will also not be maintained when you develop the RAW in post. Again, they're just for preview. When you bring the clips into DaVinci Resolve, you'll notice that you have both the RAW file, which is a .nev, as well as a lower resolution MP4 proxy file for each recording. This ensures editing performance won't be an issue if you're using older hardware. But I found that even the 8K60 edited quite smoothly when using the studio version of Resolve and using my GPU to decode the RAW footage. I rarely even noticed a hiccup or drop frames. I am using an RTX 3090 though, so your mileage may vary. Now, in the RAW development panel, you can choose from three different color spaces. It's Rec 709, P3D60, or Rec 2020, and then for gamma, you can choose either 2.4, 2.6, Rec 709, Linear, or Nikon NLOG. You also have the ability to change your white balance with Kelvin and tint sliders, and these produce mostly decent results, but it's not magic and will require some finessing to get extreme white balance pushes to match up. I found shifts between 4000 Kelvin and 7000 Kelvin to be painless, but shifting from 2500 or 10,000 won't be as easy. And watch out if you're saturating a particular channel, like shooting a clear blue sky, because this will heavily affect your gain and can have big impacts on white balance, even when shooting RAW. Basically, it's always a good idea to white balance correctly, even when shooting RAW. RAW is just more forgiving. And you also have an exposure slider. Now, there's no ISO adjustment in post, but you can use this exposure slider to compensate in the same way as ISO with the same results. I was able to match ISO 800 to 1600 and to 3200 with no visual differences, whether I did it in camera or in post. The only issue I found with the exposure slider is that it's scaled by a 2x multiplier. So if you want to increase one stop of ISO, you only increase exposure in post by 0.5. Two stops of ISO is one stop of exposure in this panel, one third of a stop of ISO is 0.17, and so on. I contacted Blackmagic about this and they acknowledged the issue and said they were able to recreate it and will be addressing it. So I suspect we'll see a fix for this soon. But in the meantime, you can use it with great results as long as you move half as much in post as you want it to be in camera. Also, I'm not sure because I don't have a Mac, but there might be compatibility issues currently with DaVinci Resolve, Nikon RAW, and the M1 Max. It works fine on PC and possibly even when using Resolve under Rosetta, but it looks like M1 users will need an update to read these files in Resolve. Unfortunately, I don't have any information on if or when that update is coming. But the process on PC has been terrific. You know, sometimes when you compare your RAW recordings to your AVC 10-bit recordings, they're different, even if they're both log, for example. Maybe the color isn't quite the same or the highlights don't clip the same way. Well, none of that happens with the Z9. If you develop your RAW to NLOG, it performs exactly how you would expect your H.265 or ProRes NLOG to perform, and you expose them identically as well. The waveform on this camera is great. It matches the Zebras, accurately shows clipping, and both the RAW and debayered NLOG clip highlights at the same point, allowing for a seamless transition between modes, both in camera and in post. So why even have RAW? Well, if you don't want to develop to NLOG, you don't have to. Now you can set the gamma to linear in post, and then transform that linear data into a different gamma of your choosing, maybe RELOG-C, for example, or VLOG. And then you can use whatever workflow you like for that log gamma instead. And I tested this quite extensively on the clips from this camera, and it works very well. And in fact, if you do convert to RELOG-C, you can avoid some of the harshness caused by the LUT that Nikon provides and actually see a little better into the shadows. With NLOG, when using the Xyla 21 and Imatest, I was only able to see about 13.5 to 14 stops total, but with converted to log C, I got closer to 16 stops. And this is obviously much noisier and not a usable 16 stops, but after you apply some noise reduction and push those shadows down a bit, you're left with about 12.5 clean stops, but with a much smoother transition out of the highlights compared to the standard NLOG workflow. You can't magically create dynamic range, and you can still get 12.5 stops of just the regular 10-bit H.265 NLOG, but the tonality and distribution will be different, and the RAW allows you to play with those subtleties and express the image using a workflow of your choosing, which is the point of it, in my opinion. Something I did notice, though, is that Nikon claims the RAW is 12-bit, but Resolve is showing it as 14-bit. I'm not sure if this is just a metadata read error or some linear versus log mismatch, but I put the question out to both Nikon and Blackmagic, and I'm just waiting on a final reply. So as usual, RAW doesn't innately give more dynamic range. And yes, it certainly is a lot noisier right out the gate. And you lose your lens corrections. But if you want to invest the time to do all that manually, you have a greater ceiling for image quality. But Nikon has great color to begin with, so other than the slightly harsher contrast when converting N-log using the provided LUT, you're not losing too much by just sticking to the standard Nikon development path. But I was happy to see that I got accurate color when using either Nikon, Ari, or Panasonic V-Gamut. Oh, and now that I have the RAW, I can validate my theory I posed in my original review when I suggested that this camera has a second native ISO at 4000, the first being ISO 800. And yes, that appears to be true because the noise noticeably improves and the image on the screen flashes for a second when switching from ISO 3200 to 4000, even when shooting RAW. Anyway, that's pretty much it. You can download this package for your Z9 for free starting April 20th. This is a truly fantastic firmware update. I mean, think about it. Picture yourself a few years ago and imagine reading, Nikon offers free firmware update that adds RAW recording internally up to 8K60. 8K60 plus the 4K60 oversampling, all the video tools, and everything else I mentioned, and you don't have to send your camera in or buy some funky token online. This is great work by Nikon. Bravo. All right. I'm done.